Welcome to my show, Confessions of a Futurist with Sanjeev Goyal. Today, I have a very special guest, Mr. Sam Pitroda. This show is about bringing futurist thought leaders, people who have built nations. Sam is the biggest example of that. He almost acted as the Chief Innovation Officer of India from 1980 to almost 1990. He set up CDOT. He's the reason every single home had landline, which was a pretty big deal in India. Growing up, I used to watch him every single day in the newspaper. Sam probably is one of the reason most of us are here, because he laid the foundation. He brought the computers to India. Sam, welcome to our show.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Thanks for your generous comments.
So, Sam, let's talk about your new book. It's very intriguing title. So would you mind sharing with our audience what is it about and what transpired you to write this book?
The book is titled Redesign the World, A Call to Global Action. It is being released by Penguin in India. Simultaneously, it will be released in UK and US. It will be available all on online platforms beginning April 26th. So this is sort of a pre-launch conversation on the book. As you know, I was born in 1942.
I disagree with that, but that's okay. You don't look that old.
That's the time the world was being redesigned. At that time, US-led initiative gave birth to UN, World Bank, NATO, WTO, IMF, GDP. That design, which was predominantly based on democracy, human rights, capitalism, consumption, and military, served us pretty well for 75, 78 years.
That's true.
You know, Transistor was born after I was born.
Yeah, so true.
I remember working with vacuum tubes.
Which year?
Transistor? 47. So I worked in college with vacuum tube flip-flops. And then I designed transistor flip-flops. And then I came here in 64 and I have seen Intel being formed. I was there when Intel was being discussed with Bob Noyce and Gordon Moore and Lester Hogan's. I've seen 4-bit processor, 8-bit processor. And I have been fortunate enough to see the whole process, some deeply with my own initiative, some from outside. And I have also seen inequality increase in the world. Very few people have become very rich, and lots of people are very poor.
You mean social inequality?
Inequality. And then came 9/11. 9/11, according to me, was a response to unipolar world.
So when you said unipolar, I am not clear about that word. Can you explain?
The world was earlier bipolar. You had Soviet Union and you had US.
Right.
You had checks and balances. Mm-hmm. When Soviet Union fell apart, you had only one power. US was the only superpower left. And the world essentially became unipolar. And then finally came COVID-19. COVID-19 gives us an opportunity to rethink, evaluate ourselves.
Yeah.
Because the world today is predominantly based on focus, very clear focus on money markets, geopolitical equations, businesses, trade, and conflicts all over the world. You know, you see what is going on today between China and US is one classical example. What went on in Iraq, what went on in Afghanistan, what goes on in, you know, what went on in Libya are basic examples of conflicts of either differences in philosophy, ideology, or grabbing for assets.
True.
When I was in America in early 60s, I was drafted to go to Vietnam. Okay. And I couldn't see myself fighting in Vietnam because I didn't agree with the idea of Vietnam War. Look at the amount of money we have spent on Afghanistan War. Okay. So I think world today needs rethinking. And when I think of the world, I come to conclusion that there are only two important things in life. Nothing else. One is planet.
Absolutely.
We need planet. Planet doesn't need us.
I completely agree.
So we need to really focus on not only climate control, our rivers, our forest, animals, birds, bees, okay?
So before we jump to that, Sam, the question I'm still trying to understand the polarization, because I personally feel it's just me, maybe in last decade, we become more polarized. Either we are yes or no. Growing up, it was more of like we have better understanding. We were ready to accept the views of other side. I see the same thing in US, same thing in India, same thing in South America. Every single place I go, people are so polarized that, don't you think that is harming our planet more than anything else?
No, I don't think so. I think polarization is hurting our democracy.
Okay.
Polarization is hurting our freedom, autonomy, institutions. But environment is being damaged by our activities, whether it is burning coal or polluting rivers or overfishing. There's a huge difference.
You are in public service for more than four decades and in the leadership role where you were defining the future of 1.3 billion people. So what do you think next 20 years we should be doing so we have a better world than the world we got into?
I think we need new economy. And that's part of the idea behind this redesigning the world. There is a chapter on new economy because our capitalism, which is a great idea, has been hijacked by greedy people, institutions, by false narratives. Today, stock market is more of a casino. That was not the idea of the stock market when stock market was set up.
True.
It was set up to help entrepreneurs raise money.
Yep, absolutely.
Now it is controlled by big money. They can take it up, they can take it down, they can pump so much money. So I think what we need is not just focus on money. See, everybody is focused on GDP, GNP, per capita income, balance of payment, trade deficit. Those measurements are not the only measurement that defined economy.
True. Very true.
I talk about this in my book many years ago in the 80s. You know, someone from US government had come to see me in India and he was banging on my desk saying, you guys are promoting indigenous development and you are blocking import in telecom.
Okay.
He said, do you realize that India is basically broke? You have only a few weeks of foreign exchange reserve.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, wait a minute, how could a nation like India be broke? Yeah. We have temples. I said, I'll sell one of my Taj Mahals. He said, no, you can't do that. I said, why not? I said, do you realize how much money we have in our temple? And then we found out recently, 10, 11 years ago, that one of our South Indian temple has five doors. We opened one door and one door had $25 billion worth of gold.
No way.
It's a world over story. It's a very famous story in the world.
Wow, I should go and check it out.
One door.
Wow.
Five.
Wow.
And this door was open after 150 years.
Wow.
Okay. So the asset of a country cannot be measured in terms of your bank balance.
I 200% agree. It's the same way there's a human.
So what we need to do is we need to create economy which is bottom up and not top down.
Okay.
We need to create economy which is not measured just in GDP, but it could be also measured in gross environmental product.
Mm-hmm.
Gross human development product. Look at all the IIT graduates. The capital, intellectual capital they bring to India. How do you measure that? On whose balance sheet is that capital? On one hand, we talk about human capital. On the other hand, when it comes to capital, there is no entry for human capital.
I jokingly said when I was talking to Piyush Goyal a few months ago, and I said, you know, what is the best export of India? This is all of us in the conference.
Absolutely.
And we have definitely, but there are a lot goes to India and what Pandit Nehru has done, setting up these IITs. These gave us an opportunity. And people like you have given lives to build that infrastructure, which we stand on today. We all know that. And I'm really grateful and indebted to what you and several people have done for all of us.
Thank you. Well, you are very generous. But I think going back to your original question about economy.
Yeah.
Today also economy, the way we measure, doesn't include everything. You see, in 40s, the measurement was very gross. GDP is a gross measurement.
True.
Because we didn't have the tools then. Today with big data, analytics, AI, machine learning, you have lots of interesting tools to measure economy, and you can really do a finer measurement.
Absolutely.
Okay. So we need really, for example, an organized sector.
Mm-hmm.
It's not in the economy. All our artisan, all our rural folks who work on textile and, you know, all that, that's not part of the economy. Economy only imply big factories and industries.
True.
That's not what economy is.
Agree. Okay. Well, Silicon Valley, everybody is running a startup with two people.
Exactly. But, you know, unfortunately, when we think of entrepreneurship, we think of Silicon Valley. We don't realize that Panwala is an entrepreneur.
100% agree.
Okay. We don't realize that Indian, you know, farmer is an entrepreneur.
So the same as every cab driver in America is an entrepreneur. I mean, I met these guys. These are such phenomenal people.
We automatically assume that technologies, computers,
that's
software, you know, AI, not true. Okay, that's not the only piece. So going back to, again, your original question, economy has to be seen in new light. So President of France had set up a group in which Amartya Sen was also one of the three active members, and they put together a report on how economy should be measured. It's a very interesting report. You should Google it.
I will do that.
And, you know, they recommend a lot of these new ideas, but people don't use it.
Okay. Why?
Because it will affect your existing balance sheet.
Okay? Yeah, but what it's a country balance sheet doesn't even matters in my opinion, because it's all about
matters. It matters to a lot, because based on that you can borrow.
I got it.
Okay. Based on that you can
borrow. Economies are connected.
Everything is connected. And everything is interdependent.
Agree.
So it's hard to see economy in isolation.
So, but still, I'm trying to understand, Sam. Give me three parameters which I can understand as a common Joe. How should we do it? I'm sorry, I'm really pushing you, because I think...
First of all, I'm not an economist. Right. I'm not an economist.
You are the expert. Please say that.
I would say if I have to measure, I would measure one from the viewpoint of wellness.
Okay. So how do you measure wellness?
How well people of the country are. Okay, see, today you look at our Ministry of Health. It is a ministry of sickness. Because they worry about hospital beds, they worry about equipment. They don't worry about wellness of the people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Absolutely.
So wellness of the people would also imply nutrition, food, shelter.
Yeah.
How well people of one country are. I was recently, 2 years ago, in Bhutan.
Happiest country on planet.
Bhutan may not be very rich, but I tell you, they are all very happy. They are all very content. It's clean air. Environmental pollution is very little. And you can see there the vibes. Okay. So happiness is not about money.
I agree.
Wellness is not about just money. So that's one measurement. Then there is a similar measurement on environment. We could be very rich, but if you have polluted cities where you can't even breathe, what good is that?
True. And recently I was reading something about the environment. I didn't realize whales produce more than 50% of the oxygen we inhale.
Of course.
50%. So, I mean, just one mammal produce half of the oxygen, and we are killing it all over the world, which is...
Everything is interconnected. A little bee. If little bee goes away from this planet, we are dead.
So how do we measure this? I'm not a big fan of the word sustainability because that is becoming...
But everything may not be measurable. Let's understand that. Everything may not be measurable.
But can we make it more about awareness so people are the behavior change? That is what is
sure.
needed.
Sure. You see, in the book, I talk about the five new pillars mm-hmm. of the redesign. If you look at five pillars of the old design, mm-hmm. which said democracy, human rights, capitalism, consumption, and military.
Right.
If we want human civilization to go to the next level, I'm convinced that you need to first focus on inclusion. You got to take democracy to inclusion. Everybody is respected.
Agreed.
Everybody deserves, you know, dignity, respect, okay, equality. So inclusion in this world is critical. Like you said earlier, when we were growing up, nobody asked you what your caste is or, you know, your religion is. It didn't matter. Now, apparently it matters.
Yeah.
Okay. So first thing is to take democracy to inclusion. American democracy is not inclusive because of race. Indian democracy is not inclusive. Look at how we treat our, you know, Dalits and tribals. Okay. Chinese democracy system is not inclusive. Second, human rights are not good enough. You need human needs. We live in an era of surplus. We can produce anything today because of technology.
True.
The key question is, what do we want to produce? Who do you want to produce for? Do you only want to produce for people who can afford to buy? Or do you want to produce for people who need it? It's a very complicated question.
True, 100%.
We only wind up producing for people who can buy because there is a market.
Yeah, there is a buyer. If you don't have a buyer, why produce? That's the theory.
That's wrong because there is a guy who needs it. He may not be a buyer. Okay, so make him a buyer. Okay, that's what Ford did in early days. Okay, he made sure that every one of his employees could buy a car.
So, okay.
So you got to take human rights to human needs.
Got it.
Then you got to create new economy. Going back to your earlier question, old economy, capitalism doesn't work as it is. It has become too greedy, corrupt, imbalanced, and created inequality. The fourth thing is consumption. Consumption is not necessarily the answer. We need conservation. And finally, military. Do you realize that we spend $2 trillion a year on military?
So that's almost 20% of our global.
Exactly. So GDP. Now we need to really focus on reducing spending on military, because for $200 billion, you can feed the entire world hungry.
So true. $2 trillion is a lot of...
So we need to focus on non-violence. I think we have arrived as civilization with great deal of maturity. We don't need to go on building all this nuclear armament anymore. Future war is not going to be fought by 2 million soldiers in the field. It is going to be fought from somebody's bedroom, you know, managing robots somewhere.
With computers.
Yeah, so... change the whole paradigm, and that's
we don't need to kill people for the war now. So war is on the stock market now, so it's exactly. Changed.
So the hyper connectivity becomes the key driver of change.
So Sam, let's talk a little bit more about decentralization, because I grew up in the world when everything was thought, how can we centralize it, because there are so much inefficiency. More centralization we do, more middlemen we cut, more blah, local offices we cut, and we create better opportunities, better world, less cost to the consumer. Now we are talking about decentralization. How do you think our world will change and will get productivity out of it?
See, first of all, we must recognize that at the time of independence, India had nothing.
Mm-hmm.
We had to build everything from scratch.
True.
India was essentially robbed. You know, in 1760, India's GDP was 25% of the world. In 1947, India's GDP was 2.5% of the world. Okay. So India had to create institutions and infrastructure to train people. So you couldn't decentralize then because there was no human resource.
True.
So Nehrus of the world started IITs, hoping that they will build bridges in India. Didn't realize that they will go and control global economy at some point in time.
Almost $1 trillion.
Yes. So initially, centralization was essential. But we probably held on to centralization a little too long. Today, every district should be independent. Every district should be allowed to plan their own destiny with own budget, own university, own hospitals, all of that. Okay. So we need to take decentralization all the way down to district. Same here, it has happened here. In America, decentralization works because when I pay my tax, city of Oak Brook gets piece of that.
Absolutely.
Why? They use that in schools. They use that in building roads. And city of Oak Brook has a mayor, by the way, who happens to be from Indian community. And they plan it properly. Okay. So I think decentralization is the only way forward. The hyperconnectivity gives you new tools that we didn't have before.
Sam, I can't thank you enough for your time today. I wish I can talk to you for another hour. There's so much we can go in depth.
Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you for the opportunity. Wish you all the best. And I look forward to remaining in touch with you.
Thank you, Sam.
Thank you.
Please have a wonderful day.
Thank you. You too.